Well, hello, everyone, and welcome again to the Barbershop Harmony Society's Big Ideas Roundtable series. My name is Chad Bennett. I'm the BHS show production manager and your host for this, our third session of the Pandemic Reopening Roundtable. We will get the conversation started in just a few moments, but first, some announcements and Zoom tips. Please remain muted. There will be a Q&A session later on, and I'll tell you more about that when the time comes. If you don't mind, take a moment now to change your Zoom username to your real first and last name. To do that, find yourself in the participants list, hover, click more, and then rename. If you need any help, send a private message to our staff moderator under BHS Admin. And that is Joe Cerruti, BHS Director of Outreach behind the scenes, here to assist me behind the behind that dark wall of the Barbershop Harmony Society logo you see. If you need to send him a message anytime, just click on that picture and choose chat. Now, if you're comfortable, go ahead and turn your camera on so that we can see all your smiling faces. Now that it looks like everybody has changed their names, take just a moment if you don't mind and type your quartet, your chapter, your chorus, and or district affiliation in the chat. We'd love to know about all the different singing communities that are represented here. And finally, for the best experience of your own, go ahead and change your view up there in the top right to side-by-side speaker or side-by-side gallery view. Now, if you joined us for the very first reopening roundtable back in June or the second session in July, thank you so much and welcome back. To refresh your memories on those, the first session was a deep dive into the COVID-19 interim guidance for BHS ensembles and singing communities document. Now, that has been updated recently, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a couple minutes. And just in case you have not seen the latest version yet, we will go ahead and drop a link in the chat so that you can follow along. Now, the second session of the Pandemic Reopening Roundtable was more of a discussion like we're having today about what some of our larger chapters have been doing regarding reopening, gathering together again, how they came to those decisions and such. And today it's more small to mid-sized chapters. Now, we do have video recordings of both the first and second sessions available for you to watch and for anyone to watch who'd like on the BHS website. And you can see those and learn a lot more about the Big Ideas Roundtable series of events by visiting barbershop.org/bigideas. When the pandemic was declared over a year ago, a number of BHS staff, along with several dedicated volunteers, formed a number of committees. And those were to stay current with related trends, plan events and programs that would be appropriate when we couldn't sing together physically, and to provide resources and tools for all those singing communities that were looking towards Harmony Hall for guidance during this incredibly difficult time. Now, since March of 2020, the COVID-19 interim guidance for BHS ensembles and singing communities has been a valuable resource for many of those communities. Now, the guidance was just updated on August 4th, so we're going to begin this evening with a very brief walkthrough of what those most recent updates are. Once we get through that, I'll introduce our panelists and we'll jump right into some questions. Now, if you have questions, feel free to drop those in the chat. We will track that. I'm guessing a lot of your questions will be answered by the questions we have already, because we get lots and lots of them. So let's talk about the guide for a moment. I do want to remind you that while I have been the person responsible for assembling and updating that document since last year, I am not a medical professional or a legal professional myself. I've only done my best to keep track of the science, be really well informed, consult with the real experts, and do my best to keep that document updated. Today, I'll probably share some of my opinions as well that may not necessarily be the same as the opinions of the Barbershop Harmony Society. So, the first thing we should all remember is nothing is 100% risk-free. With every decision we make, we should keep each other's health and safety as our number one priority. Now, that said, the best way to protect your health and the health of others is to get the COVID-19 vaccine. Now, you may remember that the U.S. Centers for Disease Control updated their guidance for fully vaccinated individuals back in May, kind of dropping that masking requirement. I'm sure you've heard by now, back in July, that recommendation was reversed due to the rise in cases and a lot of new data about COVID and its variants. With that, I will acknowledge that there has been an alarming rise in cases lately, and that's mostly due to that Delta variant. And now that we've gotten there, let's take a quick look at what the latest updates were. So, as we walk through these updates, let me remind you that almost all of the information in this document and everything that I talk about dealing with that comes directly from the CDC. Let's start by addressing those background points. Now, the first several updates are in the background section, and those are all based on updated CDC language on their website. Those include a revised description or the definition of what COVID-19 is, new links and more information about who is at risk, and what we know now about how the virus spreads. Two significant updates to that background section are regarding the variants and breakthrough cases. And if you don't know what a breakthrough case is, that's when someone who has already been vaccinated is diagnosed with COVID. After that, we did condense the coral ecosystem section, added some new information about the joint statement that came out from the Barbershop Harmony Society, the National Association of Teachers of Singing, and several other coral organizations, as well as references to the BHS Big Ideas series. There are some minor updates throughout the general guidance section, which includes a change to that updated recommendation about masking from the CDC. Some of the information under quartets has been condensed, like quarantine info, but the chorus guidance is pretty much still the same. And finally, there are a few new links in the resources section. And the resources section is what a lot of people really find very helpful. Those links in there that you can go and research pretty much everything you need to know, almost all the way down to your local level in most cases. So that was a very quick overview. Now that you've heard about those updates, it's time to meet our panelists, and I will start asking some questions. So today with us, we have several leaders that represent currently active chapters and singing communities from around the society. First, we have Stephen Banker, who is the president of the Westchester Chordsmen. And Stephen is happy to be celebrating his fifth year as the president of the Chordsmen. So welcome, Stephen. Next, we have Will Downey, the director of East Coast Sound. Will's a 10-year barbershopper, bass of the international semifinalist quartet Gimme Four, as well as director of the Caldwell chapter of BHS, not just East Coast Sound. And he's also music VP of the Montclair Dapper Dans of Harmony. Now, away from barbershop, Will is a middle school strings teacher. Coming up next, we have Cody Harrell, who is president of City Lights. That's the Motor City Metro chapter up in Detroit. And he is also the bass of our 2018 International Youth Quartet Champions, Frontier. He's been a barbershopper since about 2010 when he joined the Flint Arrowhead Chorus. Since then, he's been in several quartets, like a lot of our panelists have been. And in his professional life, he is a teacher for journalism and English over in East Lansing, Michigan. Last but not least, we have Rob Roman, who is the director of PDX Voices. He's been a barbershopper on and off for 20 plus years. And just like several of us on the call tonight, got his start competing in the collegiate contest, which eventually became the youth contest. Sung in several award-winning ensembles, been a charter member of two different BHS chapters, and he is a first-time director with PDX Voices, who just happened to be your 2019 Evergreen District Mixed Chorus Champions. And now that you have met our panelists, it's time to start asking some questions. I'm gonna stop sharing so we can all see exactly what's going on here, and why don't we jump right in? So what we have are a list of questions that we get asked most often at Harmony Hall. A lot of them have to do with reopening. How do we do this? How do we get together? And the first question that we have for our panelists is this: how did your reopening conversation start? And we'll go ahead and why don't we just do that in alphabetical order, just like they were introduced? So Stephen, do you mind letting us know how your chapter's reopening conversation started?
Well, sure. It was a process, of course. In the spring, we started singing outdoors. And when the CDC guidance came out in May, they very specifically said that indoor singing was okay. They gave it the green light. So we decided that we were ready to go indoors. And it was just a question of finding the venue, because our regular venue was not yet ready to accept us. But I think at that point, you know, everybody was ready to get inside. You know, we were tired of Zooming. We realized that the outdoor rehearsals had poor attendance and poor quality of rehearsals. So everybody was anxious to get inside. Now, I can't say, well, everybody's a bit of an overstatement, because there are a couple of guys who are still nervous and concerned. And we haven't seen everybody come back. But that's how we reopened. Of course, when the new guidance came out at the end of July, that was a whole nother conversation. But I don't think that was what your question was about.
No, thank you. That was that was exactly what I was looking for. So what about East Coast Sound? Will, how did your reopening conversation begin?
Our reopening conversation actually began with performing. We had been rehearsing since February with the car singing setup that a lot of choruses used. And we were aiming all along to do a couple of summer shows. And at one of the car rehearsals, or what was supposed to be one of the car rehearsals, our technology was kind of failing us. And so we kind of straw polled everyone that was there. And at that point, everyone that was in attendance that day was vaccinated. And so we exited our cars and sang outside. And then in preparation for the next rehearsal, we continued to make sure that anyone that was going to be present would be vaccinated. And we continued to rehearse outside in preparation for these outside shows. These outside shows were kind of a hybrid of audience members listening live via a sound system, but also anyone, since we were used to setting up this technology already, anyone could, if they elected to, they could stay in their car and listen via FM, because that's how we had been rehearsing all along, like so many of these groups across the country and across the world did with that kind of FM setup. So I'm a little embarrassed to say, kind of stumbled into it, but it was, as a small chorus, it was nice to have everyone that is a member vaccinated. And we just recently, we only meet about once a month, and we just recently had a retreat. That was our first time singing inside again. All members were vaccinated, and we required anyone that was going to be there, they had to be vaccinated.
Awesome. Thank you. Cody, how about City Lights? How was your reopening conversation started?
So we a year ago now, maybe over a year ago, going all the way back to July 2020, we were a little bit late to the game of, jumping into virtual shows and everything like that. We more so were just worried about and focused on, keeping the chorus guys going. But we did at that time develop a COVID back to singing committee back in July. And this was when there was not yet hope in our eyes, but like we needed something because the guys kept coming to us every week. Cases were up and down, especially in the state of Michigan. And that group is and was made up of four individuals, myself, one of the chapter directors, and the two medical professionals in the chorus. And we, from July, before there was a vaccine, back in 2020, we just, talked about best safe mitigation practices. And we did a little bit of outdoor singing last fall, but then the winter happened. And if you've been to winter in Michigan, you know that it's pleasant. And that outdoor singing is very possible. And so after not doing that, the COVID committee met in January. We laid out, once there were vaccines, we laid out our desired benchmarks. And we also had to come back to singing outdoors a little bit later, not because of the weather, but because Michigan endured a high spike of COVID cases where the rest of the country didn't, largely in April, with that, I think, alpha variant is now what they're calling it. And so, we were always conversing and our guys were very patient with us, but it was a lot of, extra time that our committee gave to making sure that we were reading NAFME studies, BHS sponsored studies, talking about hospitals and everything. And I'm proud to say that we have just been very blessed by the number of resources that have existed over the last 12 months to help make those conversations possible.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And Rob, what about PDX Voices? How did you guys start your reopening conversation?
Well, I have a chorus of very impatient singers. So pretty much when we started Zoom, the conversation started. So we started doing the Zoom rehearsals just like everybody else. We found that, we did Zoom rehearsals the entire time, but I feel like it kind of made everyone miss the in-person experience a bit more. And I think we kind of ebbed and flowed with what was going on there. So kind of really early on, the secretary of our chapter myself and one of the other members of the chapter kind of just started a thread on Slack. We utilize Slack pretty heavily and just kind of talked about all of the incoming information, kind of kept up on everything. I'm a nurse. We have another nurse in the chorus and, you know, keeping updated on all the things that we were hearing and the updates that we were getting at work. We kind of devised a plan to, since we're such a small group, start sort of rehearsing in pods of 4 and 5 people, socially distanced outdoors with masks. And we started kind of doing that. And then once the guidance came out from the CDC originally in May, like you've mentioned, the conversation started that maybe we should start getting the whole chorus together in a similar situation outdoors, kind of just rehearsed in parks, city parks in Portland, which is not a terribly abnormal thing to see in Portland. We've actually still been doing that and have kind of transitioned to doing like indoor sectionals to kind of get people comfortable with singing together indoors. And then since a lot of the guidance has changed as related to the Delta variant, we had to pivot away from bringing the whole chorus back into our indoor rehearsal location. Not because we weren't willing or prepared to try, but because the place that we rehearse was not allowing anybody to do any singing because we rehearse at a church's community center. But the chapter itself sought a grant from the Evergreen District to help with getting back on our feet post-pandemic, or during the pandemic, we bought HEPA air purifiers to have in our indoor rehearsal area when that actually starts to happen. We also, during the pandemic, added a men's chorus to the chapter who is now actually currently doing indoor rehearsing, and we're utilizing HEPA filters for that while having singers masked and having as many open windows as possible, those kind of things, which is really easy to do in the summertime. But we'll see how long we'll be able to do it. But yeah, the conversation started, I would say, like a month into the pandemic.
Awesome. So everybody's been talking about this for a long time. Now, here's one of the most popular questions we've gotten. And I've already heard this answered at least once, but I'm going to ask it of each of our panelists. So the question is, are you requiring your in-person attendees, guests or singers, to be vaccinated? Let's go all the way back to the beginning with Stephen again.
Okay, the short answer is yes, but let me give you the longer version as well. We decided that we wanted to have rehearsal circumstances that would be comfortable for most of the members. And, you know, we did discuss it and poll the members, and they were certainly more comfortable with having everybody vaccinated. So we have a requirement that anybody coming to rehearsal is vaccinated. We have had at least one member opposed to us that we should require the members to present proof of vaccination. We decided, in fact, the board was unanimous on this. We decided that the culture of our chorus was such that, you know, it's a bunch of friendly guys. We know each other very well. And it would be a sort of a sign of distrust or even betrayal if we didn't trust people telling us that they weren't vaccinated. So we decided not to require proof of vaccination, except with respect to guests. When guests are coming, we have had some guests over the past few weeks, I do require them to show me either their card or their wallet pass. We do have a couple of members who are not vaccinated. I mean, the vast majority of our members are vaccinated. With respect to those who are not vaccinated, I know at least two of them are probably because of their view of the world. One is because his family had some bad experience with vaccines, so he has some independent reason. And we have only one of those guys who has expressed anger towards the chorus for not permitting him to sing because he believes his immune system will protect him. But you know, if we were to admit him, then a lot of other guys just wouldn't come. So we can't make an exception for him. But everybody else singing is vaccinated. That is our standard going forward.
Excellent. Well, the second half of that question was, has there been any effect on your membership or attendance because of that requirement? And it sounds like there's at least one person that is not happy with it. Anything else to add there?
No, I think that given the size of our course, you know, we're not happy that this guy is unhappy, and we won't be seeing him for a while. But given the size of the course, the loss of one member is really not significant to us.
Got it. Thank you. And Will, I'm pretty sure I heard you say that vaccinations are required. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and whether that decision by the chapter had an effect on membership or attendance?
Yes, we are requiring anyone in person to be vaccinated. And no, I consider us very lucky that it has had no effect on our attendance or anything of the sort. We're a small chapter. We're smaller than we were pre-pandemic. But the guys who have stayed engaged are all vaccinated, and we're happy to do so. So feel pretty lucky in that regard.
Awesome. Thank you. Cody, how about City Lights?
So we, as of now, have not implemented one, but our COVID committee met today to discuss that, and we are going to make a recommendation to our board tomorrow about that. And, you know, we only returned to indoor weekly singing last week. We've been outdoor since April, and so this past week was the first one. And you know, as timing would have it, you know, coordinated perfectly with this rise of the Delta variant and everything as it would happen. But we are, and I mean, I don't see anyone in my chorus on this call, so they don't know about it yet. But, you know, we are going to be making the recommendation as a committee to the board tomorrow. And we feel good about that. And we, you know, it's important to us for a number of reasons. We've been holding out, and I'll just tell you in honesty, because we've been tracking vaccinations since the beginning. We put benchmarks in place of at certain percentages of vaccination, we would go from not singing to outdoor masked singing and then to indoor masked singing and such. And we had some percentages, but we've realized now up to this point, and we know exactly who hasn't been vaccinated. But what's important to us, you know, as we've kind of gone through this process, as we've, you know, been talking and listening to others, is that even though we understand that there are some members that are a little hesitant or maybe have, you know, a host of reasons, we know that now there's other courses who have done it. It's not unprecedented. And in talking with them and getting advice from others, this is just like anything. It's most important that we act in the best interest and health of our members. We have members who have young kids who can't be vaccinated, and, you know, we let statistics and information kind of guide that. I do anticipate that we may lose a member or two, especially because we are going to take the hard line of that there won't be exceptions to that rule. But I think, you know, just like with any policy that you implement, if you're going to implement a policy of, you know, going down a path of inclusion and not all members are inclusive, you know, you're stating an intention and a desire of the chorus. Our chorus intends to keep our members and families safe. And if this is what we have to do to meet that mission, then I won't say unfortunately or unfortunately or fortunately, but it's a sacrifice we have to make for the mission of the chorus. And so if we do, I will be sad because, as you know, Stephen remarked about his chorus, we have a great chorus culture. We really do. It's a beautiful mix of amazing individuals that I hate to be put in the situation, but I'd rather, I guess, have them hate me alive than the other way around. And so it's necessary.
Understood. Thank you. And Rob, tell us more about PDX Voices.
So I think it's kind of similar to what everybody else has said. It's not that we like purposely or purposefully monitored everyone's vaccination status, but everyone in our course was pretty upfront and almost was proud of the fact that they got the vaccine and, you know, that we were still at a point where receiving the vaccine was kind of something that felt like, okay, we're about to turn a corner. This is kind of the light at the end of the tunnel. We're getting there. And so everyone in the chorus, as soon as they were vaccinated, was talking about it. And we know that every member of the chorus is vaccinated. And that never really ended up being something that we felt that for PDX Voices we needed to put in writing or anything like that, because we knew of that status. And then, like I said, we started a men's chorus in the chapter, and we kind of started it when the Delta variant kind of started being talked about. And at first it was, let's put together this document that says everyone is assuming risk by coming here. If you feel, if you don't feel comfortable singing with people without a mask, by all means, please wear a mask. But, you know, and the same held true for PDX. And then fairly recently, we decided that we were actually going to codify it, that we want everyone to be vaccinated that is going to be participating. And we were kind of reticent to pull the trigger on that until we started seeing some of the bigger chapters and bigger choruses in our society making public statements about that. And I think the tipping point for the board of the chapter and for sort of the management teams for both choruses was seeing that the VM made their announcement. And myself as the director of PDX and Justin Miller is the director of Vocal Summit, we both kind of talked and said, I mean, if there's no better time than right now to kind of express to our choruses that this isn't an exclusionary policy or tact. What this is it's for our members' safety, and it's for our family members' safety. Both of our ensembles have a lot of younger people that have young families and older relatives that are immunocompromised and they can't receive the vaccine. And knowing now that we are capable of shedding the virus and having the virus with breakthrough infection, it's something that we can't necessarily sort of take for granted when we get together. So in regards to whether or not we anticipate losing anybody, PDX hasn't lost anyone. But we do have members of our chorus that have removed themselves from in-person singing because of breakthrough infections and the rise in Delta variant. And that's something that we are totally supportive of because we want everyone to feel safe in doing that. But we do anticipate that there may be some singers that leave the other chorus for the time being. And it's something that we're just going to have to be okay with at this point.
Got it. Thank you. And you know, that kind of brings us to another point. Somebody brought up in the chat here is any recommendations of singers' masks. And that for me personally, the Broadway singer's mask is one of the better ones out there. Just my opinion. But Cody, I saw a hand go up there. You have a recommendation on which one you prefer?
I guess it's not a recommendation of which one, but I can tell you just about them and like about the process of this, because we talked about this in our COVID committee meeting. We're going to be requiring our members when they wear masks to either wear singer's masks that we invested in. We actually had a local seamstress person. We gave them the like model and they made some for our chorus. They look pretty cool. We all have like big duck bills now. But we had those made and those have been great for us. But we also, as things have changed, we just read, you know, the updated aerosol study from NAFME and BHS. And one of the things that they found is that those masks are especially helpful if you are an unvaccinated singer. But even as a vaccinated singer, those are great, but you could also wear something as simple as just like a disposable surgical mask, and that will provide you an adequate amount of coverage too. We're not going to allow for gaiters, bandanas, and cloth masks because they just don't have the same level of efficacy. But I would say, you know, our masks were modeled off the Broadway mask, and they're excellent. The only thing I notice is that I hear a little bit more of myself than I used to. And so that's just an adjustment to get used to. The surgical masks, I don't have that same issue. But both, as the studies have proven and shown, are really effective and will protect, but also be useful for indoor and outdoor singing.
Right. Now, my personal experience with it's like a regular surgical mask or even just a smaller mask is when I start singing, it's either going down below my nose or coming up above my chin one way or the other, and it's just hard to keep in place. That's why I like either a larger mask or that's the actual singer's masks. Those seem to work better for me. That's just my opinion, though, again. Any other opinions from our panelists there as far as masking or the masks? And
yeah, Chad, I don't know if you saw my response to David.
I did, for sure.
Okay, so look, we're all vaccinated and we're singing in a non-public space. This actually has been one of the bigger issues of debate among our board with the meaning of public and whether that's significant in the CDC's guidance. But the CDC was very clear that they are requiring or suggesting, if you will, masks in public spaces. So the preponderant number, the larger number of our board members agree that our rehearsal space, which is actually very large, and has three HEPA filters in it. Our rehearsal space is only us. Nobody else is there. In fact, I don't think there's anybody else in the building when we're rehearsing, except for the janitors. So that we are not requiring people to wear masks. And in fact, nobody's been wearing masks. I think for our next rehearsal, I am going to make it clear that if anybody feels more comfortable wearing a mask, they can. So I'm curious, Chad, as to, given the CDC's guidance about public versus non-public, why did BHS choose to require or suggest masks in their most recent guidance?
Well, for us, it's kind of more related to what Cody had said, that some masks are just not very effective, and vaccinated people are now experiencing those breakthrough infections and can shed the virus. While you may have a room that's all fully vaccinated folks, there could still be people in there who have come in contact with someone who is sick. They could have the virus and just be asymptomatic. And for me personally, I have two small kids at home too. And if I go out, whether I'm going to be around people that I know or not, I tend to wear my mask. It's more for my kids, really. But if my circle of friends were older and everybody was vaccinated, I would probably not be as adamant about masking as I am right now. But again, for me, it's my kids mostly. But well, for BHS, again, it's the following the science there that says that vaccinated people are still shedding the virus and can spread it among each other. And so that's why masks are recommended in our guidance.
Well, certainly, but the risk, I guess it depends on your group, but you're right. We are an older group and we have at least one member who is very concerned about being near his elderly mother. So he's not coming to rehearsals. But I think everybody else, we've told them that there are certainly are risks involved still, although the risk of a vaccinated person becoming, first of all, getting the infection is low and becoming seriously ill from the infection is even lower. Given those parameters, we have found a majority of our members are happy to come to rehearsal. And we have also recommended that they discuss their choice with their family so to get the wives and children and grandparents involved in that decision.
And the other thing about the BHS guidance is it's intentionally broad because we have so many different communities and different areas with different case rates and different demographics. So that's, and it's more of a suggestion. It's certainly not a requirement coming from BHS. It's more of a suggestion. And that's based on what most people are experiencing. And those are other things that we would be happy to answer more questions about for sure. But I personally prefer them. It's hard to sing in a mask. I acknowledge that too. But it's each individual singing community has their own opinions on whether or not to use them or whether or not to allow or have everybody be fully vaccinated. Again, it's from chapter to chapter to chapter. It's very different. We're seeing a lot of folks starting to do more of that now, though, especially with all the recent news.
I'd love to hear what the other people on the screen are doing about vaccination and masks, not just the panelists, but the other participants as well.
So do we have any other folks here on the call with us that your chapters are requiring vaccination? Feel free to speak right up.
Great Lakes Chorus initially required vaccinations. And then when the state guidelines changed in Michigan, they opened it up to non-vaccinated, and they also dropped the mask requirement. So that's where we're at the moment. With this Delta variant, I think this really needs to be reconsidered.
Okay, so Dennis, let me ask you another quick question. Is there any other testing requirement for unvaccinated folks? Do they need to show any kind of PCR test or rapid test?
There is none. There's not that requirement.
Got it. Thank you for that info. Anybody else on the call? Is your chapter requiring vaccinations?
I'm an inactive barber shopper, but I sing in another community chorus, and we have not started rehearsing yet, but we will in September. We are requiring everybody to be vaccinated. We're not asking them to show a card, but we have them sign a document that they, yes, they've done it. And we also are requiring a liability waiver so that they can't sue the chorus because you can't get insurance for this stuff. And we are also going to require singers' masks. And that was the one that asked about recommendations there, right? Because we're just getting started on that and don't know what the good ones and bad ones are.
No, I think it's good to remember what Cody said, because those singers' masks can be a little pricey depending on how big your group is. And if you have someone that has that ability to recreate those masks.
I heard a couple of recommendations for the Broadway mask. So
yeah. The Broadway mask is very similar to the singer's mask. They're made kind of similar. So there are actually links to those at the end of the BHS guidance. So feel free to check those out too. Now, Elmer, I saw you unmuted as well. Tell us about your chapter.
Well, our chapter, first of all, we do not require masks. The location where we sing will change depending on what the CDC regulations are. We were singing at an outdoors at a parking garage, spaced out, no masks. Now we went in when the things got better and looser, and we were singing inside in a well-ventilated place, 6 feet apart, no mask. But now we have to go back to the outside because a place where we were, the inside place, that church, no longer once is in there because of the rules. So we have to move again. But basically we're all older people, we're all vaccinated. And if anybody wants to wear a mask, of course they can. But most of us don't bother. We just space out. And outside, we feel pretty safe.
Got it. Thank you. Now, friends, Elmer's experience is actually fairly common. And what I mean by that is that the venue where you hold your rehearsal, where your chapter meets, a lot of times their rules are going to trump yours. So if they have a requirement, you're going to have to follow that requirement. And in some cases, just like Elmer's chapter experienced, they aren't going to let you come back in. There's even some of our larger chapters are not allowed to have more than a certain amount of people in one room at any given time. And some of our other chapters actually have the capabilities to go in different rooms throughout the rehearsal so that it helps that out.
Well, if you have an outdoor venue, like we happen to have a nice multi-level parking garage, you go into one of the upper levels, the sound is great. It's open air. I mean, the only thing that will stop us will be when it gets really, really cold. But until then, we're okay with outside.
I love the natural reverb of a parking garage too.
Oh yeah, Always fun. Sound really good.
So, Rob or Will, any other thoughts about that before we move on?
I know that we. Again, we were going into it with the mask thing being kind of optional and just at your comfort. But moving forward now, because of what's going on, like the masks at rehearsal are going to be required again. And that's actually the one single thing that we've gotten a little bit of pushback on, because it's not a terribly certain thing in terms of like, how much of the virus we can shed, or if any of us can take. So that's the one even remote topic that I've gotten any pushback on, and that our board's gotten any pushback on. But I will say that having rehearsed now with masks on at least once, doing it in the summertime, it's terribly uncomfortable, and I think in the grand scheme of things, everybody wants to sing so badly now that people are willing to put up with more than they have ever put up with before, and would be willing to. And that's not to say that we're asking them to do it because we're trying to punish anyone, right? And I think that the constant reminder of that, I think helps to make those decisions a little bit easier to swallow.
Now, something that we've heard time and time again is this is a very difficult conversation to have sometimes. It's becoming a little more easy, but for our smaller chapters especially, having that difficult decision and potentially losing a member, even one member, could be devastating to a small chapter. In your opinions, what's the best way to have those conversations with your chapter? By those conversations, what I mean is talking about potential vaccine requirements and or masking requirements. What's the best way to talk about that with your chapter? And I'll leave that open for any of our panelists to respond to.
I think we're just having the conversations very openly. Just the other day, we had a bass clef sectional rehearsal. And at the end of the rehearsal, I asked everybody just to give 20 minutes of their time. And I kind of told them where we're at. And we have a potential show coming up in a couple of months, and kind of gauged their comfort in singing on that show, knowing full well that whether that show happens or not is going to be completely dictated by Oregon Health Authority and CDC guidelines and things like that. And gauging people's comfort with moving forward with these sort of restrictions that we're putting on ourselves for the safety of each member of the chorus and their families. And I think that's been the most appreciated thing that we've gotten, is that we're having these conversations openly and that we are seeking input from our members and not just arbitrarily making decisions. It's very easy to make decisions based on anecdotal sort of experience and evidence. But when you can back up what you're saying with research and with, you know, evidence-based practice, but also receive people's experience and kind of show some empathy and some sympathy towards them about what's going on, I think they're more willing to have the conversation openly. So I think that's been a big part of it.
We can resolve some of the hesitancies of some of our people attending by what we do is we do the outside, we do the physical meeting. We also have somebody's iPad, so if anybody doesn't want to come because they're a little squeamish, then they can join via Zoom, even though what they're looking at is a director, but that's the most important part anyway. At least they can participate that way. So we try to service everybody, regardless of their position on masking.
Yeah, sometimes it's difficult. You know, even when we were just Zooming, we actually did present some surveys to the members about, you know, what they'd be comfortable doing in terms of singing outdoors, singing in a circle, singing on risers, vaccinated, unvaccinated, mask, all those options. So we did circulate some questionnaires and got a lot of feedback. It became a little more intense when we received the latest guidance from the CDC. And it was an awkward time for us because of between board meetings. So rather than calling another board meeting, I quickly circulated the information and asked for reactions. And we have a large board. We have 13 guys on our board. We also have 5 doctors in our chorus, including 2 on the board. So I solicit the opinions of all those people. And of course, we can't get unanimity, but we can be respectful of other people's views. And that's, I think, very, very important. As I said, there was a preponderance of views headed in one direction. And I really was in the position of having to synthesize all these different views. And then I was very careful in laying out the nature of the discussion for the rest of our members. I laid out for them what the facts were, the fact that we had this lengthy discussion among the directors and the physicians, that it was not unanimous, but that the preponderance was going this one way. And then I laid out alternatives and what were the advantages and disadvantages of the alternatives. And then the ultimate line was, you know, if you're comfortable, please come to rehearsal. And if you're not, you know, don't. Yeah. And that's where we are. As to those couple of guys who are not vaccinated, even the one who was really irate about his exclusion, I always try to be very respectful to those people. I said, look, I respect your views, and we look forward to seeing you when we're able to sing together again.
Mm. My course decided, the board discussed this at great length, and all the board members said, well, I don't want to come if everybody isn't vaccinated. So we just put out the rule, hey, everybody has to be vaccinated. Had no feedback on that. And we, in July, we had a barbecue, which is partly indoors, partly out. And we required everybody to sign the vaccination form when they arrived, and they all did. And there was no problem with it. Of course, we all live in the San Francisco Bay Area, so everybody here is vaccinated anyway. It didn't make much difference.
Got it. Thank you, David.
You know, one thing that I've learned about, I guess, leadership in this time. We have found it especially important. I mean, I talked earlier about this committee that we established, but I'm gonna say this, and it's gonna sound bad. We don't always seek input from our members. And here's why I say that. Our members have, one, never been shy. A lot of them are really dear friends of mine. And I mean, we're all friends, right? So you know that if people have an issue, they're going to talk about it. We seek input from our members when we know that there's such a wide variety of options to choose from that we need a little guidance about what people's temperatures are on. And for us, you know, we got the right people, the right, you know, both medical professionals and people who had a strong investment in the future of this chorus. We consulted them. We consulted information that was provided to us by these various studies. And we had the hard conversations with the group of people that knew the most so that we could make the most informed decisions. And within that, you know, I have encouraged people to reach out with comments and questions. But I will tell you, after making really tough decisions over the last year, I can't say I've gotten more than 5 concerned emails from people saying that our decisions weren't the right ones. I've gotten 10 times more messages that they were the right ones. You know, and I think that that has been a huge show of, you know, in doing this kind of work, it's so important to have a group of people that are dedicated to doing this, that can present it in a really logical, informed way, and that are trusted stakeholders in the chorus. Thankfully, the people on that committee aren't just medical professionals and invested, but also they're culture guys. They're guys that, you know, in the chorus people look to and that they respect and that they love. And so, you know, even though we take a very fact-based, logic-based approach, they understand that, well, if these 4 guys put their heads together and come up with this, you know, it really matters and it makes sense, and that we understand that that's the path that they're taking and we trust that. And not that everybody, I can't say everyone's agreed with us the whole way, but we find that when we ask for too much, you know, kind of input from everyone, that we stray from the evidence-based practice and the information-based practice, and we spin into those anecdotal-based kind of approaches, which aren't bad, but, you know, they don't always tell the full story. And there are so many of them. So I would say that for anybody who is trying to lead these conversations, find, you know, it's not about asking everyone for every opinion every time, because that's not a sustainable leadership model, but it is important to find trustworthy people, and put all their heads together and let them have that really tough conversation, because people who love each other can go into that conversation and know that they'll come out of it, not maybe with, as I think Stephen put it, we won't always agree, but we will come out of it unified, because we know that we have done everything to make sure we've covered every base, talked about and uncovered every rock. And there's something really beautiful about that process.
Great, thank you. Now, we've heard it mentioned once or twice tonight, and it was mentioned a lot on the last one. And this one, this next one is regarding inclusivity. When we do have a vaccine requirement, there are always folks who will, for one reason or another, not be able to get vaccinated. And how do we continue to include those in our chapter activities? And what we've heard tonight and a lot before is offering a Zoom experience at the same time or some kind of web experience, a simulcast or even recordings. Do you all have any thoughts that you'd like to share regarding that? And not just about Zoom, but how to remain inclusive or be more inclusive, thinking of the folks who maybe can't join us in person right now.
We are kind of even spinning it further as East Coast Sound, and we have a fairly uncommon model in that we only meet once a month. We started as a chapter that met for a few months leading up to the midwinter convention and went to the Youth Chorus Festival. And then when the age requirements for that festival changed, we decided to charter as a chapter. But we kept, because a lot of our, it worked for a lot of our membership and it was keeping a lot of our membership in the hobby, we kept the once a month model. So we have that model, and what we're planning to do now that Zoom and video conferencing is more ubiquitous and we have this technology that we bought to enable our car rehearsals, we are going to have a distanced membership option where members can attend the rehearsals virtually most of the time as long as they come to one in-person rehearsal in a block of time. So regular members who for whatever reason might not be comfortable coming to rehearsal can explore that, but we're also going to have a distanced membership program since we do have this kind of unique model of only meeting once a month. And that can kind of jive with a distanced member. So that is our plan.
We have a different plan, actually. After a year and a quarter of Zooming, we found that our Zoom master had his own version of Zoom fatigue. So he really didn't want to be doing it anymore. But we have another option. We actually record every rehearsal in full. And then post it for members only. So if members are interested in watching that rehearsal and singing along with the rehearsal, they can do that.
All right, well, friends, I'm just going to ask a couple more questions. If you, our other attendees, if you have questions of your own, now is the time. Go ahead and drop those in the chat. Or if you wait another minute or two, you might be able to ask them yourself. Because we are coming up to the 1 hour mark. So let me ask a couple more questions. Again, think of those questions that you want to ask, drop them in the chat, and we will get to those momentarily. So the next question I'd like to ask you all is, based on what you're experiencing now, think of that versus when you first came up with your plan. So how have your results compared to how you originally formulated your plan for your chapter? And what, if anything, would you do differently?
Our results... improve when we went away from the Zoom meetings and into the actual meetings. So our plan was to do Zoom until things cleared up. And the results were mixed. We socialized more. Well, I don't think we got any better singing-wise because you can't hear each other. But we stuck to a plan, and it changed when the conditions got better. I don't think we could do any more, given the fact that we don't have the expensive equipment to overcome the technical glitches that you have when you do Zoom. We did the best we could, and one chapter which I visited. Actually, gave us an idea. The guy just put a lead, something that we could all listen to, and then everybody muted themselves, and they had their own private little session with a lead part, and that's not really satisfactory. It's better than nothing. And so that was it. You know, there's not much more you can do. So there's no way to do anything else other than what we did. I can't think of, if somebody can give me some ideas, that'd be great, but.
Yeah, one of the ways that we're measuring how we're doing is attendance. And granted, that's not really the only way or even the best way, but it's an easy way. So before the pandemic, we were averaging about 50 guys at each rehearsal. And while we were Zooming, we were getting maybe sometimes 55 or 60 guys on a Zoom because we were bringing in people who don't no longer live in the area. When we started moving outside, we'd be getting 20 guys, maybe 25 guys, because it was a different time because we wanted the daylight. And that was not so wonderful. When we moved indoors, it started slowly creeping up, 30, 35. Then the first week after the latest CDC guidance, we dipped down to 25 again indoors. But I think that some of the absences there were for other reasons, because our last rehearsal, which was, you know, last Monday, again, indoors unmasked, we had 40 guys showing up. So there are obviously a lot of guys who are comfortable with our current protocols.
I'll say this. The one thing I don't think we necessarily anticipated when we came up with our plan, because our attendance right now is, I mean, I would say we get anywhere from, you know, 2/3 of the chorus to, you know, 80% of the chorus at any given point. We don't have 100% attendance at this point. But the one thing I don't think we anticipated was, because of the amount of time we've had away from making chorus rehearsal a priority in our schedule, in our life schedule, people got used to kind of planning their life outside of the chorus. So we're in the middle of the summer, where in the past, our biweekly rehearsal was a part of your Sunday night kind of get ready for the week schedule. And we've run into people making other plans because that's what we were doing during the pandemic when everybody was locked down and quarantined. Yeah. And breaking out of that, I think, has been the toughest part for people is, you know, we become obsessed with Barbershop when we're doing it. Like that's who we are and that's what we're doing. But when we didn't have it immediately available to us for a year and a half, we kind of had to find other ways to cope and other things to do. And getting out of that habit and getting back into the rehearsal habit, I think, has been the biggest challenge for us.
Yeah, that sounds a lot like our experience, Robert. I think our leadership was, we were hovering around 35 members before the pandemic, leading up to going to our first international. And we were, while we weren't expecting, we were, you know, through the pandemic on Zooms. And then when we went to the car singing, we had, you know, anywhere from 15 to 18 guys. And I think with both moving to the car singing and then also our first and only indoor rehearsal at the end of July, we were kind of expecting this flood back, maybe not up to right where we were, but it was pretty much the people that stayed very engaged through the pandemic were the, and again, small sample size, it was one rehearsal for us, but I kind of anticipate it being more of a slow build back up than that rush of people. And it actually reminds me of Kevin Keller's keynote from midwinter and the urgency of re-engaging your membership on a personal level. I think was basically his message, that it's not going to be this automatic, oh, well, we weren't doing it because we couldn't, and now we can, and we're going to come back. It needs to be an active process if you're a leader in a chorus, to connect personally with these people. That's such a good point. If you're not a diehard, like probably most of us who have taken the time to be on this call tonight, you know, then you probably made plans otherwise, and got used to that. That was a really good point. Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, and all the other panelists have made really excellent points. And the only thing I think I could add is that, even the diehards, none of us are the same people that we were 18 months ago. And there have been times I've wanted to burn out and stop being a chapter president and having to make all these terrible decisions. And, you know, there have been times I've wanted to go to chorus and not, and open up the Zoom. And, you know, we're different people now than we were then. But if there's anything that I'm proud that we've worked and been able to maintain, is that no matter how many people have come to a rehearsal or a Zoom or what, the chorus culture of the guys that have remained active is still largely the same. We have a range of, you know, ages, like a lot of choruses do. We're auditioned, and we have a range of ages from 12 to 74. And it's a lot of young guys and several older gentlemen, and it's really silly. And we're just very, if you have young guys in your chorus, it's just a lot of dumb boys together. But what's nice about that is that, we talk to each other inside and outside of chorus. We have a game discording channel for anybody that knows what that is. I don't think even I said it right, but, you know, we've got a lot of other ways that we engage with membership that isn't Barbershop. And I'm not going to pretend that everyone's going to come back or has come back or will come back to Barbershop, but, they will sing tags with me. I can invite them to a tag session, maybe if not a chorus rehearsal. And then maybe after singing tags, I can, you know, invite them to, oh, come listen in, or like, if you're always welcome, you always come hang out, right? There are so many ways to get them back into our lives and hope that they're all going to come back together. But if they don't, I'm still going to keep them in my life. I'm still going to, you know, try to engage them in Barbershop, and engage them as friends. So I think that whatever you can do to keep that chorus culture going is the most attractive thing to returning and new members, because we got a lot of those wanting to come. So
awesome. Thank you so much. Now, I have one last question for our panelists, and then we will look to our attendees for more questions. If you have them, if you don't have them, that's okay too. That last question is, how has the rise in cases, or the Delta variant, or all the craziness, all the updates that are coming out now, how has that affected either your plan to reopen, or how has it affected your rehearsals?
Well, we can't go indoors. I think that's the primary one. And like I mentioned before, it kind of forced a couple of members to make the decision to kind of self-isolate or quarantine again, just because one of the members has a newborn and doesn't want to risk getting them sick. And the other one has a sick parent that they are primary care for now. So I think, yeah, Delta definitely kind of pushed them over the edge in terms of making that decision. So,
right.
Well, that's where the Zoom comes into play here. That we've got a couple of guys that don't want to show up because they don't want to show up. They've got their reasons, and at least we can keep their interest that way. And the other Delta has, that's one of the things that closed off the church indoor meetings. Mm-hmm. The church decided no. So yeah, it has affected us. Fortunately, we have the outside until it gets cold. So we're still treading water here.
We had a board meeting this week, and we had a very difficult discussion about, you know, are we doing the right thing? You know, there are one or two guys on the board who were sort of pushing toward going back outdoors. And the rest of the board was, you know, happy to stay indoors. So it'd be interesting to see again what happens at our rehearsal tomorrow, what kind of turnout we get. I am going to add, we do send out an email on the day of every rehearsal saying, you know, don't come if you've been in contact, don't come if you've tested positive, yada, 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 don't come if you're not comfortable. We will add now, you know, feel free to wear a mask if it makes you feel more comfortable. Mm-hmm. But we will continue to have this discussion even between board meetings, because as circumstances change, we will have to decide, is the change in circumstance sufficient for us to reconsider our position? And that's something we think about daily. What concerns me most right now is, you know, we have a couple of performances scheduled for the fall, and I don't know what's going to happen to those. I think with respect to, you know, the chorus being fully vaccinated, if we continue on that path, I'm not concerned about the chorus as much as I am concerned about the audience. We haven't really discussed what kind of requirement we're going to put on the audience, whether they need to be masked or vaccinated.
Just to piggyback on that, we just had a discussion about that with our chapter board. It's like, you know, if we can find a venue that's going to allow us to put on a show, that venue is going to have their own set of precautions. But on top of that, how do we even know if an audience is going to show up if they're being told they have to socially distance and they probably will have to wear a mask and, you know, and all these other things? Like, I think it's a fair question that we, for all of us to ask, is what kind of an audience do we anticipate performing for?
Well, the only audiences we've performed the last couple of times have been in retirement villages. And there, we were lucky enough to be able to unmask to sing, and the audience was far enough away so there was no problem. And when we finished the performance, we masked and then we mingled around masked, but we were allowed to sing without masks. So that was a plus for the singing quality and the comfort of the members.
I feel pretty lucky because we had a retreat at the end of July and we're actually not meeting in August, and we have until the middle of September to kind of feel out, but we'll definitely be having the same conversations we've been having for so long now about what's right for that September rehearsal. Even though it was planned to be our second indoor unmasked rehearsal, we'll see if kind of where we're at that point and make the decision to either mask or go outside, if the weather permitting. But yeah, we'll be having those conversations.
You know, I talked earlier about the recommendations that we're going to be making to our board tomorrow. But I think our overall approach, especially based on the Delta variant, I guess in theory, we're a little bit thankful that, the Delta variant has affected us, but it was a little scarier in Michigan in April, I think, when we were going through something that couldn't, or that wasn't necessarily reflected in the rest of the country. And so, you know, when we went through that and that felt kind of like the worst of it, not from the numbers, but just from what is going on. We very thankfully are going to continue to meet as long as the CDC, as long as we continue to follow the guidelines that have been put in place and the recommendations made for us. We always will listen to member concerns. I think the big thing right now, I'm an educator. And so, even though I teach an age range of all of which are eligible to be vaccinated, I have both friends and a roommate that are immunocompromised that could, you know, even though they're vaccinated, could still be affected. And I know we have course members who have kids who are unvaccinated. And so I think it will not be a challenge for us to, you know, use that as evidence-based practice that we're going to keep and continue to keep the most safe route possible. And that, you know, the Delta variant will make things, I mean, we all want to see each other's faces. We really, really do. But we've done it this long and we can continue to do it because as long as we can keep singing together, we will be able to make it work.
All right. Well, friends, we are coming near the end of our time. I'd like to ask if there are any more questions from the audience or from our attendees this afternoon or this evening. I will take that as a no. So it sounds like we've answered all your questions this evening. Maybe not. No, we're giving you examples from all around the country, around the society, from a lot of different perspectives. You will, of course, have to do what's best for you and your singing community and your region and your area. Take a lot of details into account. Make sure you check out that guidance. It is not gospel. Make sure you do your own research and find out what's going on wherever you are. All your venues will have their own restrictions, that kind of thing. I do want to send out just a quick poll. I know there are not a lot of us here this evening, but it's not going to let me do the poll this evening. Oh, well, forget I said that. So since we are at the end of our time, I do want to thank again Stephen, Cody, Will, and Rob for joining us this evening. And Elmer, you too. We appreciate your contributions. Talking to us. We appreciate all of you for being here and keeping the safety of your singers as your highest priority. So again, we're going to try to do this again in September, sometime around September 12th, to continue these discussions. Now, as we all know, the circumstances of the pandemic can change daily. So we may even have a new version of the BHS guidance by then. So make your plans to join us on September 12th. And if there are any final thoughts, I invite you to share those right now.
Just thank you for inviting me to be a part of this. And I want to encourage everybody on this call to just keep doing what you're doing. And let's keep our community singing some way, somehow. Yeah. Just that first time back together was so nurturing for the heart. And I think none of us really realized exactly how much we missed it until we finally had it back. So just keep your people singing.
Beautiful. Thank you, Rob.
Second that for sure.
All right, friends. Well, stay safe. Thank you again for joining us. You'll be able to watch this in another day or two, along with the first two episodes of the Pandemic Reopening Roundtable. So thank you again for joining us. Have a wonderful night, friends.
Thank you, Chad.
You bet.